Well, with the Christmas, you know, lights are out and the kids' Christmas choir and all the feels and the sights and the sounds of Christmas, the holidays are here. And I just got to know, just entertain me here for a moment. Are there any other major Christmas slackers like myself where you have not bought one Christmas present here? Come on. Vulnerability and truth. I love you, people. I love you. Let's just say Amazon Prime, if you've ever primed anything, you better prime this week. And so the holidays are here and you know, we see it, we smell it, we're feeling it, but we, Jacob and I, also know that the reality is that life can hand us some challenging things, some hard things, and if you're here today, you're here this morning in the midst of all the sights and the sounds and the smells and the feels of Christmas, but your heart is heavy. You're walking through something, maybe physically, emotionally, spiritually. We want you to know that you are in the right place today. And it's our honor to bring you hope from the Word of God. In church, if that's good news, let's hear it. Let's just celebrate that here for a moment this morning. Hope from the Word of God. The Christmas story. The Christmas story is such a short story, only a few chapters, really, a couple verses within those chapters that articulate and tell the story of one of the most miraculous moments that obviously has affected all mankind. The Christmas story is short, not too long, not even a whole book dedicated to the actual birth of Jesus, just a couple chapters. But in this short story, it is filled with so many amazing truths, dynamic truths from the Word of God for our life today. And I feel like God has been so good and so gracious here on this December 15th weekend to gift me a word for all of us here today. Those who came to the 9 a.m., you were here at the 11 a.m., all you watching online. A unique angle of the Christmas story for our hearts and our lives today. So I hope you're ready to grab something here this morning because I believe God wants to gift some hope and some revelation for our hearts today. See, the Christmas story, there's something I noticed new for the first time as I was praying for you, praying for this time, going over this message, is I noticed something unique for the very first time. The Christmas story, all the key people that have a part to play, from Mary to the shepherds, Joseph, all these key characters and people that are a part of the journey that make up the Christmas story. I noticed something for the first time. And what I noticed is going to be the title of this message here this morning. And what I noticed is a series of what I would call holy interruptions. Interruptions in the life of the people that make up this Christmas story. Interruptions by God for a holy purpose. And I believe God's word is alive and it is living and it is so good that today, as we look at just three of these holy interruptions that are part of the Christmas story, I believe you're going to be able to identify with one of them or maybe all of them, and you're going to leave the house of God this morning a little bit stronger than you came in. I believe today is a holy interruption for us and for our hearts. So church, are you ready for the word of God this morning? Holy interruptions. The Christmas story, it's often told only out of Luke chapter 2. That's often where we hear it read, where it's preached about in churches and in, you know, traditional or non-traditional settings. Luke chapter 2 is where the Christmas story is often preached from, but Luke chapter 1 is actually where it begins. Luke chapter 1, and we're going to look at verses 26 through 28 this morning to find our first interruption here in the Christmas story. And it says this: in the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a village in Galilee, to a virgin named Mary. She was engaged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of King David. Verse 28, Gabriel appeared to her and said, "Greetings, favored woman. The Lord is with you." If you're taking notes this morning, you can write this down. The first interruption we see starting in the Christmas story in Luke chapter 1 is found in verse 28, a holy interruption of favor. A holy interruption of favor. Verse 28, Gabriel says, "Greetings, highly favored woman. The Lord is with you." The favor of God, what is the favor of God? Maybe you can assume what it is or kind of put your church history together enough to make your own definition, but I want to make the favor of God so easy for us to understand and picture and put our hands on here this morning. The favor of God, or God's grace is another word for God's favor, is God giving us the ability to do something which is humanly impossible for us to do. The favor of God. It is God gifting us the ability to do something that is humanly impossible for us to do. Let's just stop for a moment and celebrate salvation. How many of you would agree that salvation is the favor of God on our life? That we can be in relationship with Jesus. We don't have to work it. We don't have to earn it. We don't have to try to deserve it. We get the favor or the grace of God to have salvation, to be saved, to know where we're going to spend eternity. So why in the world did Mary need a holy interruption that begins with the angel telling her who she is, which is favored? I believe that this first declaration, interruption in her life had to begin with her understanding and acknowledging that she was favored because the assignment that was about to be given to her would seem impossible. What was about to follow next, the angel would begin to tell her how she will carry a child and she'll become pregnant with a child, not outside of natural ability. The Holy Spirit will impregnate her and she'll have a child that's not just any child, but it's a savior of the world. How many of you can agree that sounds a little impossible? And the weight of the impossibility of the assignment that she was about to be entrusted with had to begin with her hearing and understanding that she was favored. When we see the favor of God, church, in our lives, when we acknowledge the favor of God, that it's present, that it's available for us, when we see it, when we acknowledge it, and when we access the favor of God, what's going to happen is we're going to begin to move from surviving things to thriving in things. Mary was about to receive an assignment that was so heavy, that was about to send a ripple effect of chaos through her life. Her relationship with this man she's engaged to would not understand and would, for a time, leave her, break off the engagement. People would talk about her. I believe there would be nights where she went to bed pregnant, so confused, but just trusting that the favor of God was going to help her to do the impossible in this assignment. And in your life, there might be relationships. There might be a job, there might be a circumstance or a situation that feels like you are simply surviving it. Do y'all know what I mean when I say surviving it? I've been there many times. But what the favor of God can do is it can grace your life with an ability to even walk through challenging assignments that are so impossible in the natural. And what the favor of God does is it comes and it takes you from a lane of surviving that relationship, just surviving that report, surviving that job, surviving that marriage, to actually thriving in it. See, Mary's ability to not only hear the holy interruption that she was highly favored, but to receive the fact and understand that, yes, she had the favor of God on her was critical for her to walk out this assignment that was about to be given. And here at Thrive Church, we don't play games. We don't pretend that everything's just easy and full of cotton candy. Here at Thrive, we believe you're going to thrive with new life in Christ as you invite God into the journey of the highs and the lows. We let his favor and grace collide with that. And I think we can all agree that sometimes life hands us hard assignments, doesn't it? Life hands us hard assignments. I had a woman, she came up to me after the 9 a.m. and her eyes were filled with tears, but there was a smile on her face. And she says, "Hannah, 2019 handed me an assignment I was not prepared for." She said, "In January, unexpectedly, I lost my husband. She says, but I have to tell you, as I reflect and look back from January 2019 to December 2019, it has come with an assignment that has felt impossible, but I have heard and accessed the favor of God, and I am here today able to stand because of his grace and favor. I had another young woman come up to me after the 9 a.m., and she had this beautiful little baby with her, and I recognized her, but she looked different. She wasn't pregnant. And I said, you've had your baby? She said, yes, we had the baby, and I have to tell you something. She said, back in 2012, a doctor told my husband and I we would have a 5% chance of getting pregnant. She says, we have gone through failed fertility things. I've had three miscarriages. She said, this child is not only here today because I had him, but he is a miracle, and they named him a name that meant heaven. Come on, church, the favor of God. Life can hand us hard assignments. And maybe at the end of 2019, I'm so glad you're here today because I know God knows your story. I'm so glad you're here today because I just know 2019 hasn't been made of just cotton candy and easy moments. Maybe you are here today and 2019 has brought you some impossible moments. Moments like maybe Mary felt where an assignment was given to her that, without the favor of God, I can't do this. Without the grace of God, I can't walk through this. And maybe you're here tonight and 2019 has brought you these moments, and I'm so good, I'm glad you're here because I'm so aware of the love of God for you here today, and he has brought you here. You are watching online because this is a holy interruption for your heart and life to know you don't have to do this on your own. Whatever feels impossible in front of you, we just need to access a greater measure of the grace and the favor of God. And as you look at 2020, maybe there's some things floating around in your heart or your mind today that excite you, feel a little foolish in nature, feel a little impossible if God doesn't come through. And some of you here this morning, you might be hanging in the balance of believing God for these things are starting to hit your heart and your mind for 2020 because 2019 and 2016 and 2010 want to kind of tell you, hey, remember what happened back here? Remember what happened in 2010 in your marriage? Remember what happened in 2016 with that child? Remember what happened in 2019 with your health? You're foolish to believe those things for 2020. Well, I'm here to tell you today, if you're in the balance of believing God for great things and taking cues from your past, I'm here to tell you this is an interruption of God's favor to tell you to believe him that he redeems and he can restore and he can make all things new. This is the God we serve. Oh, and I just love this. I love how certain things in the Word of God are so clear. It doesn't hide anything. I love that when the angel comes to Mary, she is doing nothing special. She is smack dab in the ordinary. She's not found in the temple. She's not found in some prayer meeting. She's not found doing some religious tasks and duties. She is just existing and doing the ordinary. And in the ordinary, the angel comes to her and says, you're favored. And I just feel like this is for someone here this morning because you just need to know that favor is not dependent on how you feel. Favor is your spiritual inheritance as a son or daughter of God. Favor is not something you have to earn and you have to work for and you have to make sure everything's lining up perfect and you've got favor today. Favor is yours right in the middle of the ordinary. And we don't have to earn it. We don't have to work for it. We don't have to wait till the preacher says you deserve it. You can have full access to the favor and grace of God right now in the very assignment that's in front of you because of the cross and because Jesus sent his only son. And he died, but he didn't stay dead. He is alive. Church, if that's good news, say amen. An assignment, an interruption of God's favor. Number two, if you're taking notes today, the second interruption I see in this Christmas story, we're going to go one chapter forward. It is found in Luke chapter 2, starting in verse 8. You got the shepherds. hanging out, watching their sheep. And this is what happens in Luke chapter 2, starting in verse 8. That night, there were shepherds staying in the fields nearby, guarding their flocks of sheep. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them. They were terrified. But the angel reassured them, "Don't be afraid." Isn't that good? Fear is real, isn't it? And it pops up in lots of different ways. And here in the midst of the ordinary, of the shepherds watching sheep, the glory of God comes. And the first thing he says to them is, "Don't be afraid. I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David, and you will recognize him by this sign. You will find a baby wrapped snugly," I love that it says snugly, "in strips of cloth, lying in a manger." How many of you would agree that good news is a good thing? I love good news. And here at the second interruption, Luke chapter 2, is a holy interruption from heaven of good news. I love what Proverbs chapter 17, verse 22 says. It says, "A joyful heart is good medicine." I found that to be true. And I just want to take just a moment in this number two interruption. We've talked about the favor of God and accessing God's grace and his favor in the various assignments and places we find ourselves in today. And in the second interruption, I think there's something new for us to grab a hold of. And I'm so excited because some of you are going to grab a hold of this and you are going to exit 2019 even stronger than you entered it. And the second thing I see in this interruption of good news is one of our greatest weapons as Christians is found. One of our greatest weapons we get to use as believers to really defeat the enemy and fight the things of this world, and it is the weapon of gratitude. The weapon of gratitude. Maybe you've heard growing up in church or just around the church world, Thanksgiving, having Thanksgiving, being thankful. And let's not underestimate the power of thankfulness here this morning. I want to prove it to you in the Word of God. See, our gratitude creates an atmosphere in our life. If you're married, children, single, wherever you might be, our gratitude or lack thereof creates an atmosphere. And that gratitude, what it will do is it'll create an atmosphere of joy. And the Word of God says that the joy of the Lord, not just worked up joy, not just fake joy, but the joy of the Lord that can come from a holy interruption of good news. And we begin to activate the weapon of gratitude. It creates an atmosphere of joy, and that joy creates an atmosphere of strength. And once again, what are the shepherds doing when the angels come to him? Ordinary things. Nothing super holy. They're not found in a little shepherd prayer circle. They're just watching their sheep, doing life, doing the things that they need to do. And a holy interruption of good news comes to them. And then the atmosphere changes where they are. Where these shepherds are just existing, an interruption of good news comes, and now the atmosphere changes, and look what happens next because of this atmosphere change. Verse 15, when the angels left, returned to heaven, the shepherds said to each other, "Let's go to Bethlehem. Let's see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." An interruption of good news created an atmosphere of joy and expectancy that moved these shepherds out of the ordinary and towards the presence of God. And do you know what happens when you get in the presence of God? Everything changes. See, the weapon of gratitude will change your atmosphere. It'll change the atmosphere in your heart, in your mind, in your home, in your marriage, with your children. And what will begin to happen is because the atmosphere of your life is changing, it's going to draw you towards the presence of God. The weapon of gratitude changes everything. And I just want to encourage you and show you how to use this weapon. You might say, "What does that mean, Hannah? I just walk around my house saying I'm thankful." Well, kind of, yeah. See, the good news ultimately is what? It's the Word of God. And if you don't have a Bible here today, we'd love to get you one. We've got these Bibles back at the black tent. We'd love to put one for free in your hand. But the Word of God is the good news. And see, I find in my life, if the atmosphere is not right for too long, I get an invitation from God to change it through the weapon of gratitude. And sometimes it's hard to find things you're thankful for. Ever been there before? Sometimes when the atmosphere has been too ungrateful for too long, Jake and I will literally sit down and say, we're going to write down what we're thankful for. I thank you, God, that when I put the key in my car and turn it, it starts. Can I get an amen? I thank you that when I open the fridge, there's food in it. I thank you that there's shoes on my feet. See, like, we just have to begin to activate thankfulness. But the good news is the Word of God. And man, if you don't know where to start, you can start by just saying out loud and thanking God for John 3:16. If you've been around church any length of time or watch football, you know what this scripture is. It says, for this is how God loved the world. Oh, I thank you, God, that you love me. That he, God, gave his one and only son. Thank you, God, that you gave your son. So that everyone, you, me, we, who believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. You begin to activate and speak the good news. And I'm telling you what, as you speak the good news, the atmosphere in your life will begin to change. Things don't go away. Trouble's still there. Victories still happen. It's all still existing. But the atmosphere in your mind, in your heart, in your home can begin to shift. And when the atmosphere of gratitude gets to be put into motion, it draws you towards God's presence. Sometimes when I don't feel like it, but I just begin to declare the good news of the Word of God, other things start sticking, coming up in my spirit, coming up in my heart. Okay, Lord, I thank you for salvation. I thank you for breath in my lungs today. I thank you that I'm alive to be a mom to my kids and alive to be a wife to my husband, okay? Ooh, I'm feeling it. This feels good. God, I thank you for my husband. I thank you for these three kids who need something from me every second of every day. And all the mama said, I think I'm grateful. I don't know. I thank you, God, that you are for me and not against me. Okay, whoo, here we go. Hannah's speaking some gratitude up in this house. And that's what I do when no one's around. And I just had a bad one. And Jake's like, hide from mom. She's mean today. This is what I gotta do. I got to change the atmosphere. God, I thank you that you are providing my every need. Thank you, God. I thank you that I can trust you. Thank you, God. I thank you that I believe in you, but Lord, help my unbelief right now. God, I thank you that you are with me in the valleys, and I thank you, God, that you are even with me in the mountaintops. In church, so many times this declaration of good news ends with tears just pouring down my face, not because my situation changes, not because the valleys all of a sudden become mountaintops, but simply because activating the weapon of good news brings me into the presence of God. Activate a holy interruption of good news. Good news will move you towards God's presence. And as you look at the end of 2019, I pray you can pick up this weapon and begin to use it. So that what? We can act like everything's good? No. So that I can forget what's happened? No. So that I can live in a la-la fairyland, that if you love God, everything always works out? No. Because God says, in this world, you will have trouble. But take heart. I've overcome the world. I pray you activate this weapon so that you can experience a greater measure of God's presence in the atmosphere of your life. Y'all ready for number three? Someone say three. Oh, that was good. I said 3 like a 9 a.m. Y'all know you're God's favorite 11 a.m. Broncos games in here. You're in church. Look at your name and say, you done good. That's what I thought. The third interruption, a holy interruption of the miraculous. You know, I don't know when it happened, but somewhere after I fully gave my life to God as a teenager, I feel like God gave me the gift of faith. You know, the Bible says that faith is a gift. And the gift of faith is not dependent on your personality, your Enneagram number. Come on, all you Enneagram freaks out there, I know you. It's not dependent on what you've gone through or what you're experiencing. The gift of faith is freely given. You know, there's so many gifts that the Word of God talks to us about that some of us don't have because we haven't asked for them. And, you know, the third interruption I see here is a holy interruption of the miraculous. And before I read this passage, I want to encourage someone here this morning. Maybe you've never asked for the gift of faith, or faith is just a struggle. Or maybe as you take cues from 2019 or the last 10, 15 years, it almost feels foolish. Well, this is what I know. When I go through things that attack my faith or slow it down or even confuse it, moving forward, the faith is different. It's not the same faith today at 39 years of age. I don't have the same faith as I did as a 16-year-old girl before she experienced any life. But I still have faith that God can do the miraculous. And sometimes the miraculous comes in strange ways and unusual ways. In church, the Christmas story, a miracle that impacted all mankind, came in a way that was preceded with heartache, challenge, difficulty. It doesn't make sense. Why would God do it this way? But this interruption of the miraculous happened. Luke chapter 2, verse 16. And they, the shepherds, hurried. So excited. You just imagine. I'm like, let's go. They hurried to the village and found Mary and Joseph. Which, first of all, poor Mary. She's got all these crazy people popping in this manger. It's like, help us, Jesus. They hurried to the village and found Mary and Joseph. And there was the baby lying in the manger. Someone say miracle. Let's just think about that. We've read that so many times. Some of you have heard it so many times. Maybe someone's here today. You were hearing this for the first time. Isn't that a miracle? The angels come to the shepherds, tell them, go. You're going to find a baby. He's Savior of the world. So they hurry. They go. And there was the baby lying in the manger. Wow. Like, let's just slow down for a moment. Christmas season so filled with get it perfect, don't miss a beat. Get the presents, make all the parties, get everyone on the list, plan the meals. And while we're so busy doing all of this, I know we're all walking out our own assignments, our own roads. We need our own interruptions of the favor and grace of God. We need our own interruptions of good news. And we need our own interruptions of the miraculous. The Christmas story is a story of the miraculous that is preceded with such challenge, such heartache, such, really, God, why me? I was Tuesday night, had the honor and privilege of praying with a woman my age, healthy, strong, just diagnosed with a brain tumor. A bunch of us gathered around her and believed God for healing. And after we pray, she says, I don't know why this is happening. I don't know why this is my story, but I'm just going to believe God for a miracle. And, you know, sometimes that's all you've got. And this is all Mary had, this journey. Why would God do it this way? Why would he entrust her, put her on an assignment that would cause her fiancé to literally walk away from her, to not believe her? Why would God put her on an assignment that would cause those closest to her to talk about her, to whisper about her? Why would God give her an assignment that was so full of the impossibility that even she probably at nights, even when that baby would kick, struggle to believe the reality of it? I don't know, but that's what makes up the miraculous. And then to bring her on a journey to where the miraculous had to come in a way that was filled with so much discomfort. Come on, people. She had the Savior in a barn. Surrounded by animals, discomfort, and stink. What if something were to go wrong? No one there to help. But this is the miraculous. Verse 16, and there was the baby lying in the manger. A miracle. And sometimes we just have to pause and look at the simple miracles that are around us. God, this has been hard. This has been difficult. This isn't what I thought, but here's a miracle. Salvation's a miracle. My husband's a miracle. my three children, even though they're super naughty in the Christmas choir in the 9 a.m., they're miracles. Miracles. And after seeing him, shepherds told everyone what had happened and what the angel had said to them about this child. All who heard the shepherd's story were astonished. But Mary kept all these things in her heart and thought about them often. And the shepherds went back to their flocks, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and all they had seen, for it was just as the angel had told them. And 2019 isn't over. Still got a couple more days to it. And God is in the business of still doing the miraculous, but maybe it's going to come in a way you didn't imagine. See, Jesus, the greatest miracle of all mankind, came in a way that was not glamorous, was not well-planned, did not make sense, brought a lot of heartache and struggle with it. But our God is in the business of the miraculous. He is still in the business of the miraculous. And I just like to believe that in that moment, as Mary held her child, she listened to the shepherds and she looked around her. Never thought I'd be here. She looked at Joseph. He chose her. He came back to her. She thought about the journey, all that she had to go through to get to this moment. I believe she, as she held this child, she was so aware that in the midst of all of it, a miracle was born. For some of you here today, God just wants to so gently and graciously tell you, he's still in the business of the miraculous. And today is a holy interruption for your heart that whatever that is and whatever that needs to look like and however that needs to be delivered, it might be so far from what you ever thought or would have imagined it would be. But he wants to gift you something miraculous here. Exiting 2019 and heading into 2020. Amen, church? Would you bow your head and close your eyes here with me this morning? A miracle moment preceded with a lot of heartache, challenge, and tough moments for Mary and Joseph, but all leading them to this moment, a Savior's birth, Jesus, who is alive today. We thank you, God. We thank you, God. Lord, we just take a moment and calm the chaos, calm the questions, calm the excitement. And we thank you, God, for a holy interruption of your favor. Grace for the assignment. We thank you, God, for a holy interruption of good news, a weapon of gratitude. That's going to begin to change atmospheres that are going to draw us to your presence again. We thank you, God, for a holy interruption of the miraculous in our life now and in 2020.